You're listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network, now the largest new media platform on the web, and your number one source for after-show entertainment.
Very good, Johnson.
The AfterBuzz Studios in Los Angeles, California, presented by Maria Menounos and Bing.com, and streaming live thanks to Akamai Technologies, this is AfterBuzz TV's 666 Park Avenue After Show. We'll break down tonight's episode and get you all the latest news and gossip. If you'd like to buzz in on tonight's show, you can buzz us at 424-256-1729. That's 424-256-1729. And now, another post-game wrap-up show for your favorite TV show. It's AfterBuzz TV's 666 Park Avenue After Show.
What's up, everybody? I'm so hyped. I'm like throwing my hands up for the AC/DC intro to Highway to Hell, which is so appropriate for our Halloween week that's coming up and for 666 Park Avenue. You're watching episode 4, Hero Complex. I'm Derrial Christon, along with the lovely and beautiful and talented co-host. Please introduce yourself.
I'm Sofia Stanley.
And I'm JJ Jurgens.
Well, ladies, we have the fourth episode. And let's get right into it. Let's start with our homegirl, Anne. All right. We see Anne at the top of the show tonight. She's tied up and gagged. Kandinsky's in her face. He's threatening her. And we see her a little bit later on escape, run to her editor's house, Ned, who she tries to call. And as she's standing at his door and calling him, she hears a phone ring. And when she hears the phone ring, she realizes, like, okay, something weird is going on here. I need to possibly, you know, assess the situation. She goes down, puts her hand on the rail, sees a little bit of blood, notices a bloody body. So Mr. Ned, the editor, is deceased. And we know who killed him because our man Kandinsky calls her on the phone afterwards and threatens her again and says that she's going to be next. What did you guys think of that intro? Because I personally was scared a little bit after seeing it.
Oh, well, you know, I thought, evil her again, you know? She already created this monster. And then to go ahead and then throw Ned under the bus, you know, I was very disappointed in her. You know, she needed to suck it up and just keep other people out of it at that point when you realize you just made a monster come to life. You know, so she basically got, you know, somebody else killed.
I agree with JJ because I think that if she was going to buy herself time, then she should have potentially thought of somebody else. Right. But I think that what I got from it is, and I think we talked about this in previous episodes, is no one gets something for nothing. And again, she wasn't even creative enough to think quickly on her feet. Like, she really was a novice. She was in well above her head. So presumably, if you think you're not only about to die, but you're about to be tortured, she's going to throw out any name, and she looked at the newspaper and she threw out his name. That didn't bother me so much. What bothered me was then that's when you call the cops. Like, right. Even if it's an anonymous tip, you don't go yourself after this man just tortured you, right. And you're going to do what? So that's the part I think I didn't like. I kind of actually understood her throwing out her boss's name because I think it was kind of an impulse. It was that natural survival instinct. It was what she did afterwards that I kind of wasn't so pleased with.
I just felt like she should also make up a name.
Yeah.
I mean, just make up someone. Make up someone who lives in a totally different state.
You know.
Oh, no, good.
No, I was thinking the same thing. And then the only reason I thought differently was you have to be pretty savvy to do that. And you have to actually not be scared.
That's
and
true.
So the funny thing is, the only problem I had is if Kandinsky is kind of this mafia dude and, you know, a Russian enforcer, he would have known that she couldn't withstand that level of torture. Even though she lied, that was kind of like, he should have known, like, she's not sophisticated enough to have done this,
right,
or to have lied, but at the same time she did. So she was just buying herself time. Like, I don't think people are smart enough to go, okay, I'm gonna make up a name that's not, no, you're gonna pull from your warehouse of information. And I think that's why they did the deliberate camera angle to the newspaper.
Right.
So that's why she pulled up her editor's name.
Well, poor Ned bit it. And then, I felt sorry for Ned. But then later on, we see her talking to Gavin because she's obviously scared. She wants Kandinsky to disappear from her life. Gavin then mentions to her if she writes another article for him that Kandinsky will disappear. So she puts together this article, and I think in quote, Gavin said to her, basically that if she would write this particular letter, that Gavin would disappear about, he wanted her to write a letter about the corrupt city planning commissioner. Gavin says, he wanted her to write the article because she was a person who wanted to change the world with her writing. So what did you guys think of her going to Gavin with this, first of all, and then talking to him, you know, basically to fix the problem with Kandinsky? Would you have gone to Gavin? I wouldn't have gone to Gavin, I don't think.
No, I would not have gone to him. I need a minute to think on this one for a little bit, so go ahead.
I actually would have either gone to Gavin, because obviously she knows that in some way that's the source of her trouble. Everyone goes to Gavin because Gavin can, in fact, fix things. Or I would have literally, you know, cashed out every available money that I would have had, and I would have jumped on a plane and gone far, far away.
Right.
But I think that those were her only two options. And so I think she chose correctly in terms of that was the root of her problem. I think where she wasn't thinking was, okay, you're playing with fire and you already stepped into something and didn't think about the ramifications. So in a certain extent, like, I would actually prefer when these people make deals that they're willing to deal with the consequences. It's kind of this naivete that's starting to bother me, because you already created a murderer, like, out of thin air. Like, yeah, that's some crazy stuff.
So is he technically a ghost? Is he?
I don't think he's a ghost. I think he's an actual, like, a manifestation. Like, I think, just like he said, like, you want to change the world with your words, or, you know, they have the saying that, you know, words can come to life on the page. I think that's the symbolic thing. I think he was real, because, I mean, he did real things.
Yeah.
So that's my thing. I definitely think it made sense for her to go to Gavin, because that's the root of her problems. But at the same time, I'm still amazed that people just don't leave.
I think I would have jumped on a plane and went to Jamaica or something like that.
I think I would have wrote a really nice story before, so, though, like, that kind of took care of. Obviously, she knows everything that she writes is coming true.
Right.
So, well, then she should have killed him.
To try to, yeah.
That's true. That's a good point. She should have just written something that killed him.
Mm-hmm.
Well, a little bit later on in the episode, we see that she does write the letter, and they are at a dinner. A gala? It was a
the mayor's dinner.
The mayor's dinner. So they're at the dinner, and we see Kandinsky come in. And before that, we see everyone there, and Kandinsky comes in and is attempting to shoot the commissioner and Henry, which we'll get into a little bit later. And when you think that he gets pushed away. And when we think that it's actually Henry or the commissioner who's been shot, it's no other than our girl Anne, who's laying on the floor with a bullet in her head. So now, that scene I did not expect. Did you guys expect Anne to disappear so quickly, since she just appeared last week? I mean, I thought she would continue on through the rest of the episode.
I thought she was definitely going to be done by this episode, because when Gavin was saying to her, "I promise you, you'll never see him again," I took that as Kandinsky was going to keep living on, but basically that she was going to die. So he wasn't really, his promise was kind of tricky in the sense that he was just basically saying, "You're going to be dead, so you won't see him again."
Right.
So I saw that one coming.
Sofia, you?
I actually did not see that one coming, because I thought that when he basically said, "No innocent bystanders will die," that he was actually talking about the commissioner, because the commissioner was in fact a crook. And that's why even when Henry mentioned, like, "Oh my God, you really are a crook," Gavin was right. He didn't argue with him, because he really was. I think that where the twist came was the intersection of Nona warning Jane. Because if Nona has never warned Jane and Jane had never screamed Henry, then either Henry or the commissioner would have gotten shot. And I don't think that in the melee, then Anne would have been there and Anne would have gotten shot. I thought it was a pretty cool juxtaposition that she was the one, in fact, who got shot, and it came to fruition because she wasn't an innocent bystander. Mm-hmm. So I think that was the twist, and I think Gavin was happy that that happened that way, but he wasn't sure, because
he wasn't sure
which way Henry was going to go. So I think that in his mind, Henry being a hero is what he wanted to happen, but he wasn't quite sure. Mm-hmm. And I think it shows that he doesn't know everything. He puts things in motion and hopes for an outcome, but he can't actually guarantee an outcome at all times.
And that's where I still was a little bit confused, because I think a couple episodes ago we talked about, I think I brought up the point, does he know everything? And I think you said the same thing, that he can't know everything, no. because there would be certain things that wouldn't happen. And to your point, you're right. I mean, I guess tonight was an example of how he doesn't really know fully everything that's going to happen in the once things are promised or made. Before we get into the in more detail in tonight's episode, I do want everyone to go to iTunes and rate us and comment. We love to hear what you have to say about the show. It helps us to improve every week. Not only can you comment on the show, but we also have about 50 other shows that you can download. We have Dexter, we have Scandal, we have The Walking Dead, Revolution, a plethora of different shows that you can go and enjoy on iTunes.com and rate all of those shows. So please go and remember to do that as well. Thank you for the applause. All right, so it's a nice safe way into Nona. You were mentioning Nona as she warned Jane about the potential of certain events that are going to happen that happened tonight, which I'll get into a little bit later. But we see at the top of the show that Nona is making cookies. What it appears to be, she's making cookies in her apartment. We once again don't see her grandmother, but she's making these cookies. The doorbell rings, and was it Ingrid, Ingrid who came to the door, and Ingrid is her therapist. So Ingrid had on these fly sunglasses that we saw during the episode after they had a little bit of a conversation. Ingrid leaves, Nona leaves with her, they're in the elevator, and I think you pointed out, JJ, that the sunglasses were not were they clipped to her shirt or something, or on her head? I think you pointed out that they had disappeared a little bit, or maybe it was you.
Well, the glasses were, she wasn't actually wearing the glasses. The glasses were on her bag.
Right,
and
they were
so
on her bag.
Nona noticed when they were in the apartment, and you saw Nona kind of gaze at them. And right before, when Nona walked her to the door of the apartment, you know, Ingrid was saying something, and she hugged her like, oh, you know, thank you so much. And that's where she got the glasses.
Right.
Ingrid then goes, you know, downstairs, and then Nona, you know, proceeds to leave, and Jane sees her in the elevator, and she has the glasses.
She has the glasses. And then, because Jane complimented her on the glasses in the elevator. Mm-hmm. And we see that I think Ingrid asked a question about her sunglasses being gone. And Jane had complimented her on those sunglasses again, I believe. And we see that Jane notices that the sunglasses are no longer on Nona. And Nona has a little bit of a facial reaction towards Jane looking at her in this way. And then Jane sort of, I think that's when she gets an idea that that obviously Nona took these glasses. So she didn't call her out, which I was expecting her to sort of do, but Ingrid leaves, and then she starts to have that conversation with Nona. Now, do you think that these two are, do you think that with the episodes that are coming up that they're going to build more on their relationship, or do you think that it's, what do you think that the relationship's going to go from here?
Yeah, I think they're going to build more on their relationship. I think, because clearly Nona sees visions and so does Jane. So I think they're going to get closer and closer and realize probably when other people are thinking that Jane is a little crazy, you know, if her husband starts not believing her and the things that she's telling him, I think that's going to be, they're going to confide in each other. Because she kept telling Nona over and over tonight, you know, like, well, not over and over, but she mentioned a couple times, like, if you need somebody to talk to, and she saw herself in her. And so I really think they're kind of starting to develop that bond.
Yeah. And then Nona, a little bit later on, as we were mentioning before, she warns Jane as she's getting out. Nona gets out of an elevator. Henry's there. They're going to the gala. She touches Henry's arm, and she says she tells Jane for Henry to stay away from the guy with the compass tattoo, which we later find out is Kandinsky. And it's, you know, her. We seem to be getting more and more about her visions, and then we see that. I think that. Personally, I think that they're going to have something where they get a lot more attached to each other, and maybe they can use their visions together to solve some of these mysteries that are taking place. One thing that was revealed tonight also is the grandmother appeared. Mm-hmm. And what did you guys think about that? I mean, what did you guys think? I'll give my comment later. What did you guys think?
I was actually surprised. I really somehow didn't think that there was a grandmother. I really didn't. I really thought that somehow that the grandmother must have either passed away. I just didn't actually think that there was a physical person who was her grandmother. It then definitely made me extremely curious when because I think of the way that Jane said, I'll always be there for you, the fact that she said to her grandma, you know, maybe Jane can help you / us. So obviously the grandma looks like she's in some kind of a comatose state. And the fact that she specifically mentioned maybe Jane can help us, that had to be a help in terms of that empathetic or empathic connection and not necessarily help from a medical perspective.
Right.
Yeah. So I'm extremely curious.
Yeah, and we also, well, it's funny, when I saw the grandmother, I almost was wondering, is she going to be a person who has visions as well somewhere down the line? Even though she was in a, was she in a wheelchair? She was in a wheelchair gazing out of the window. I was wondering if they were going to develop her to have some type of psychic powers as well, or maybe she was in some type of comatose psychic world that will be revealed a little bit later. But we also we also found out that Nona's parents were killed, and that she is just living with her grandmother. But I was happy to finally see the grandmother appear because we hadn't really seen her before. Her relationship with Jane is one that's interesting to me, because they are so similar, but I still wonder where it's going to go from here with those two. I still haven't figured out like how they're going to really help each other down the line, even though I hope that they do.
Well, I think that, just kind of jumping ahead real quick, from the previews from next episode when Jane's in the red dress, remember we had that foreshadowing when she first took Jane's necklace,
right?
That was the same red dress that she was in when it seemed like Jane was being attacked. So I think that somehow, and I know I should say this for predictions, I'm not going to, somehow she's going to save Jane because she already saw the vision.
Right.
That's number one. Number two, I think the fact that she gave Jane her necklace back, I think that's actually going to come into play. I somehow think, and I think that JJ's mentioned this before, that presumably her grandma had some kind of power, but I think that the necklace is some form of protection. So now that she has it back, I think that somehow that's going to connect itself, that Nona's premonition and the necklace are going to save Jane in the next episode.
You think, okay, I like that. But do you think that Gavin knows or has any indication that Jane and Nona have these visions at all? You don't think that he knows anything about that? I think he does.
Tell me why you think he does.
I mean, I just feel like, yeah, he doesn't know everything that's going on in there, but there are so many points that he is aware of, and he places things in certain ways for the tenants in the building. And Nona is obviously a tenant in the building. He has to know certain things that are her powers, and that she's there for a reason. So I think that he has to know something about her having these visions. I just really do. I mean, he knows everything, a little bit about everything that's of the people who are placed in the apartment complex.
Simply because he knows she has visions, or do you think he knows what the visions are of?
I don't think that he knows fully that what her visions are of, because I don't think he would allow her to actually speak with Jane as much as she does if he knew that. But I do think that he knows a lot of things that are going on with her that we just haven't seen yet.
And I 100% disagree with you.
Why?
I think he doesn't know anything about her. I think that specifically, and I think that ironically, I think it was Michelle who brought this up a couple of episodes ago. I definitely think that, again, what is she? She's probably like 14.
I think she's supposed to be about 14.
She's about 14. I definitely think that children exist in a world that we don't really see them.
Right.
I think it's very easy to dismiss them. So I think that she's not really even on Gavin's radar. That's the first thing. I think that the fact that we've now been introduced to the grandma, I think it's the grandma that's in the building for a particular reason, and presumably it's the grandma that made some kind of deal with Gavin. So Nona's kind of just an ancillary part of the deal. And just even, I think, like you said, I don't think that Gavin could in any way have someone who has the power that she has who's not under his control. As well as the fact that I think her powers are, she's just discovering them. I think it's obviously connected to things that are very close to an individual. It's not like she can just sum them up. So even when with Henry, it's because she tripped and she grabbed his arm and touched the watch.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? And that was it. That was the connection that she had with him. It wasn't just that there was a vision at that time. It was the connection with the watch. I think that if Gavin knew that she had visions of any type, given that Gavin has secrets, Gavin wouldn't allow it. Gavin can't have anything in his space that he's not either controlling or aware of. And a young 14-year-old who has the possibility to see things, there's no way he knows. I think it's going to come to a head, but he has no idea.
Yeah, I think the grandma, now that we've seen her, I think she is the one that made some sort of deal with Gavin, and that's why she's stuck in this state. Because it was seen clear that she is maybe in this zone because if she saw something, or, you know, she's now this is kind of her, her payback for whatever deal she made with him, which I'm guessing is probably also what caused Nona's parents to get killed.
Yeah, I want to know more about that.
Yeah, I don't think that's just like her parents died when she was young. I think whatever deal the grandma made probably affected her parents. And then that's how she got in the buildings, because she didn't have parents, so that she went to live with the grandmother. So I think that might explain why Gavin would have somebody like that in the building, that it wasn't really by his choice.
Exactly.
But, and then, so yeah, I'm not sure what to, at this point, I'm going to say that I don't think he knows about her powers yet.
Okay. Two against one.
I could be wrong.
All right, why do you think she actually really did get back the necklace? I was on the fence about that.
I'm actually surprised that she didn't give back the necklace at the beginning. Like when basically Jane basically was like, okay, you're obviously the thief.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And she realized that Jane wasn't going to turn her in, and she turned in everything else, but didn't turn in the necklace. That actually is what surprised me. Because it didn't make sense. Like, why would you return everything other than the person who has the potential to tell on you?
Right.
You would definitely want to give them back their necklace. But when she gave it to her, when she did, it made perfect sense to me, because I think she really is starting to feel like Jane's an ally. So even when they were in the elevator and she's like, oh, I guess Jane told you that I'm the thief. And Henry was like, actually, no, she didn't. And then the way Jane, because that, think about it, like, of anyone, she would presumably tell her boyfriend, even if she wasn't going to rat you out. But the fact that she didn't even tell her boyfriend, I think that is a sense of loyalty and trust that Nona kind of is like, okay, I can trust her, and somehow then gave her back the necklace. But I'm still confused at why she didn't give it back to her with the rest of the stuff.
Okay, I mean, I can get with that. But now I had another question. So we saw once again that Nona's seeing a therapist. Who set up the therapist? I mean, if her parents are not there and the grandmother seems to be in this comatose state, who are doing who set up the therapist?
What do you think?
Go ahead.
I don't know. I actually don't have an idea. I mean, the only thing I can guess is that possibly maybe after her parents died, that somehow some type of the system somehow said, okay, your parents have died, we're going to put you in contact with this person who's going to kind of watch over you. Maybe that's it. But it still seems to me that wouldn't at one point the therapist or these other people sort of ask a little bit more questions about the grandmother. The therapist did tonight, but aren't people a little bit more curious about how this little girl's running around this hotel and clearly, you know, running her life on her own? I would think that someone else might notice that. Yeah.
The thing about the therapist is I was just guessing that it was like the state or, you know, the court system or whoever would handle a young child when their parents died. Also, she made a comment like, see, I'm getting better. You can say I'm getting better. So that indicated to me that maybe she did something that got her in trouble with the law and being a juvie, that they were like, okay, you have to go to therapy now because of your actions. And so that's why she has to meet with us. That's just what I guessed.
It works. Yeah. I just was curious because I was like, that's one little piece of information that I haven't really seen. I was curious about it because I even thought about it the other weeks when the grandmother hadn't appeared. So,
yeah.
All right. Well, we also have our man Gavin and Henry tonight, which obviously have been playing a big part of the roles in the last couple of weeks. We see that Gavin's being interrogated, and it opens up basically with Henry going into to his office and the ADA. It's ADA, is that what we decided it was?
Assistant
District Attorney is questioning him on his involvement with Gavin. And, you know, Henry's obviously a little bit nervous because of his political relationships and where he's at in his career. And the ADA basically is saying, listen, you know, we know that you know more than what you're saying, and we know that you know information. So then we see him later on having a conversation with Gavin. It goes back and forth. There's the question of loyalty that's involved with Gavin and Henry, but we see that Gavin clearly still wants to keep Henry under his umbrella in camp. What did you guys think about that, the whole scene tonight with Gavin and Henry? Sophia, you coming from the lawyer background, mm-hmm. and I know you had a lot to say with this one.
Actually, I really didn't. I think that Gavin is always 10 steps ahead. That's why he told Henry that he was under investigation before Henry then went to work and found out he was, in fact, under investigation. I think that the only thing that was a little bit upsetting was how quickly it seemed like Henry rolled over. So they have pictures of you with the person who owns your building.
Right.
I would have literally told them to kick rocks. Like, no, because they're pinning you in a corner without anything. Simply pictures of one of the most powerful men. It's not like he's a criminal. So the fact that he then all of a sudden thought, okay, like, then he has to be a crook. Versus, why are they pushing me into a situation where no matter what, you're now going against a friend or a colleague or someone you have befriended. So even let's just argue that Gavin is a criminal, there's still disloyalty. And I think that's why later on in the episode, when Jane basically says, I don't care what zip code we come from, you need to be the man that you're meant mm-hmm. to be. And I think that's why he didn't give up the information, because regardless of who pushes you in a corner, you need to be honorable. And that means you don't spy on your friends, regardless of what they're doing. You may distance yourself, but you don't spy on them. So I even thought that the interaction with Gavin, I mean, I think Gavin was kind of straight up with him. He was like, I haven't actually held any of my cards back. Gavin actually from the beginning was like, I'm being friends with you because I think that you potentially could have aspirations in politics. And
he was trying to push him in that direction.
Right. Too, but so. I think ironically, Gavin's always been straight up with him. Gavin's like, yeah, I like you because I think you're gonna have political aspirations and I like having powerful people around me.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if he's been completely straight up, because clearly he had files of him, you know, on his computers and research. Which, so he's definitely maybe
scene.
Straight up, but straight up with, for sure, clear, you know, an agenda.
Yeah, and we saw Henry. Oh, no, Sophia, what do you?
No, go ahead first.
I was gonna say we saw Henry go and try and download those files with his little zip drive, and then jumps out the window when he hears Olivia coming back into the office. And what does he do? He leaves the cap to the freaking zip drive. On top of the computer.
Which I gotta say, a very ballsy move for him to go up
was
to their penthouse. Yeah, I don't think I would have, to even attempt that was, like, I think, a side of Henry that we haven't seen so far.
Yeah.
So he's willing to take risks.
He's willing to take risks. I think with Henry, too, he wants to make moves. You know, he wants to make some career moves, and I think maybe he was in turmoil of knowing who was actually telling him the truth. So.
Yeah.
It's making him, I think, make different choices than what he would have made two episodes ago.
I completely agree with you, but I think that he made the wrong choice.
Why?
And I think at the end of the day, he made the correct choice. Because at the end of the day, you never want someone to make you do something because they're blackmailing you. That's just dishonorable.
Yeah, how do you get out of that?
No, but at the end of the day, no. I mean, this is going to sound silly. That's when you actually give Gavin a heads up. Straight up, they didn't say that you can't tell Gavin. I'd basically go to Gavin and be like, I don't know if you're a crook, so I'm gonna remove myself, but they want me to do X, Y, and Z, but I'm not gonna do it. So I wash my hands of all of you, and you let the chips fall as they may. And I think, ironically, that's what he did at the end, because that's what he said. He was like, I have the information, but I'm not turning it over. Because anytime anything starts off in a dishonorable way, that taints the entire process. And that's why Gavin was so happy that he didn't give up the information regarding Greenpoint,
right?
Because he wants him to be honorable. He wants him to be a hero, and that's exactly what...
It was a test.
It was more than just a test. I think he's really testing his honor, and I think he wants him to be honorable. There's something... Gavin does not view Henry like he views a lot of these other people. He does not view him as weak. He views him... He's said on several occasions, you're like me, you're like me. We have to fight, and we have to fight together. And I think that... He put him under a test, but again, I don't think he's really hid that. And then and I'm jumping around a little bit. The files on his computer, I think that was weird because there was a file folder on the desktop of his computer.
Which is so
that
obvious.
Was weird,
yeah.
But even that to
obvious.
Me was a test. That also.
You think that Gavin completely
set that up. Gavin is playing everyone. Gavin is 10 steps ahead because he just wouldn't be that careless in general. That's number one. Number two, you're forgetting, and I can't remember because I think Gavin actually, his background could be that he's a lawyer, but let's not call him a lawyer. Let's just say he's a deal maker, but I think I remember that.
I think he said something.
I think I remember that. So at the end of the day, he's going to have files on everyone.
Yeah.
You cannot be presumably a Trump-esque character and not run a full background screening check on everyone you interact with, let alone he has now kind of taken Henry into his fold and he's grooming him. So it means he needs to know who these people are. And that's even why Olivia was like, you know, oh, you have a big dinner to go to. And then, you know, that's why Jane was like, okay, I went to a vintage store and I got, you know, a vintage Dolce and Gabbana for like $9, because they're grooming them. There are steps right. that they need to take. So that on the surface didn't actually alarm me. It more alarmed me that I'm like, oh, Gavin's setting you up, because he's presumably going to put something in there to see if you took the information, to see if you looked at the information, because then you're going to spill the beans and you're going to say something and he knows that you looked at the file.
And where I'm going to mm-hmm. agree with you on that too is that just even the way that Gavin handled it, because he took the file cap and gave it to him at the event. Mm-hmm. So he clearly knew. He did, you know, he wasn't guessing who was on his computer. So I will give you that. That's true. I just want to know. I want to know a little bit more backstory on Gavin, though. I want to see where he really came from and how this is all developing. I'm sure we're going to get it, but it'll help me with some of the questions that I have with the things that we're talking about tonight, mm-hmm. like what he really knows, how this all started, why Henry so much. You know, I mean, I get it, but I want to fully understand this entire background on it. So, all right. So let's talk about our ghost girl. That's what I'm calling her. Miss Ghost Girl, who's underneath the bed consistently. Now, we were talking about this. I thought it possibly could be Sasha, the daughter of Gavin and Olivia, but you don't think it is, or you guys don't think it is.
No, I did, because I agreed with you that other time last week or the week before when we first talked about her. And I thought, well, because she was, you know, they did say that Sasha liked to, sorry, I can't talk tonight. Sasha okay, liked to, like, yeah, you know, explore around the hotel, and she was so curious at a young age. So I thought maybe it was her at that point.
And I actually had the same thought process when we watched initially. And the only reason that I changed my mind was that obviously Sasha was of driving age
right.
when she passed away.
That's true.
So unless it was, actually, no, it still could be. Okay. I initially mm-hmm. thought it wasn't because Sasha passed away at driving age, but I forgot that technically, like, ghosts can appear in whatever state
form.
They feel comfortable. Yeah. And I can't remember the exact time frame, because this little girl seems like she's, what, about nine?
She's like nine, 10.
Yeah, I don't think it's Sasha, because even Olivia mentioned that there was a time when she lost Sasha before she actually passed away, that somehow there was a disconnect.
Yeah.
But
mm-hmm.
I think it was later than nine.
Why do I want to say 14?
Right, that sounds right for me too. So I'm not quite sure who the little girl is, but whoever the little girl is, I think is intimately connected with the person we then figure out is in the suitcase, because
yeah.
I think she's close out of fear. Like, she's actually watching because she knows he's going to get out and she wants to be able to see where he is. And that's why I think she warns Jane. She's like, shh, he's going to hear me.
Right.
And again, and I know this isn't maybe the time that we're going to talk about it. So Jane obviously felt enough of angst to then realize that she shouldn't be playing with a suitcase.
Right.
Why put it in your closet?
I know.
Like, I was thinking the same thing.
Why not put it back where you found it?
But what was up with all the digits changing? I kept waiting for the digits to pop up 666 on both sides, but I know that would have been the most, you know, predictable answer.
Yeah.
But I was trying to figure out what exactly the digits were, what she was trying to get the digits to do.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off, JJ.
Oh,
later on, I actually thought that maybe it was, this was just a thought, but when we see, which we'll talk about in a sec, this black cloud of a formation that comes out of the suitcase, I thought maybe it was the little girl who was trying to keep the ghost was trying to get out, and she kept changing the digits to keep the lock locked.
Oh, I get
and
what you're saying.
And maybe the ghost was trying to get the lock to where it needed to be with the right code, but she actually was somehow manifesting the numbers to change so the ghost couldn't get out. But it was, you know, that might be far-fetched, but that was a thought that I had.
While we're talking about this, can we also talk about how now Tony, the doorman,
yeah.
so he has visions like Jane? Like that whole scene kind of got me a little bit, because I was like, wait a second.
Yeah, I didn't necessarily even think that he had visions. I thought he just kind of got roped up in the situation more than him having a vision of what's going to happen.
Like somebody took over him for a little bit, made him...
Like, yeah, almost like an outer... Like he was possessed
in a trance.
Oh, okay.
Because once he was in the room, saw the suitcase, and had that vision, when they showed him in the hallway, you know, he kind of shook his head like, did that really just happen? Like, what just happened? Like, you know, does this really go on? It was a thought to me that it was just his body had gotten possessed, but he didn't have the actual vision. You know what I mean? But what is your thought on that?
No, so I agree.
Oh, okay. Now, who do you guys think that the guy in the black cloud is? I mean, that was an interesting formation because we saw him twice this particular episode. So what is this black cloud that you think? I'm trying to figure that out. Do you think it's one of Gavin's helpers? Or is it, I was also thinking maybe it's some tenant
who went nuts.
Who was in the building, something happened, and so there's going to be some storyline with the suitcase and the tenant. Because only certain there's a message that's clearly trying to get, that the person's trying to get to Jane. So what, you know, I think this person's not going to end up being necessarily evil. I think this person's going to try and help out Jane in the end. That's what, somehow, I think.
Interesting. Mm.
That's what I think.
Interesting.
Somehow, or hold some key piece of information. Because why does he seem to be wanting Jane so much? That's he or she, but it looked like a he when he came out. But it seems like he has some connection to Jane that he's trying to let her know about. And for some reason, we don't know why.
I still feel like there's something that we sometimes miss, is that separate than Gavin, the Drake is also a character.
True.
And so I think that, and I can't recall when Gavin purchased the Drake, but I think that just even thinking about 2 episodes ago, and I can't remember her name, but the lady basically who was like forever young, the Black Widow.
Oh, the Black Widow.
So her crime technically predates Gavin's ownership of the building.
Right.
Right? And there was another murder. Do you know what I mean? Like, there's one or two things that we've seen, like, in terms of either flashbacks that predate Gavin's ownership. So it shows that the Drake itself, you know what I mean, in terms of even the dragon on the floor, yeah, and the news clippings. So I think somehow I still contend that Gavin is some kind of steward of the building. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why, but I'm not saying he's good, but I still think that he has more layers, that he's not as evil as he seems on the surface. I'm not disclaiming that he's not doing bad things, he's not manipulating people, but I still feel like there's some stewardess of the building, and that presumably, I don't know. I'm still working it out, but I don't think that the guy is there to help Jane. I think he's completely there to harm her.
Yeah.
And I think it's because she sees things that other people don't see. And if you have a foreshadowing, then you know what you're getting into, and presumably you may tell other people.
Right.
Versus everyone else is, I think, mesmerized by the gloss and the glitz of this building,
right,
the gloss and the glitz of Gavin and Olivia. She somehow is the only one who isn't, she's kind of like, you know, she goes about her business like normal, and she
right.
sticks her nose where she shouldn't, because that's just what she does, and that's who she is. I think she's always honorable, and I think it's not a coincidence that she's the one who pulls back Henry to his moral compass of center.
Yeah. And that's a good point you made about the building being haunted. I think sometimes I forget that point because we get so focused on the characters that they show. So that's true. The building it's a haunted apartment building. So there's a lot of levels that probably can take place in that. All right. Well, I think right now is a good time to go to some news and gossip.
AfterBuzz TV News.
What do you got for us over there?
I just have a little something on the building, which is funny because you were just talking about the building still being a character. So I just read in, I think this one is in the Wall Street Journal, that the creator David Wilcox actually chose this real building in New York called the Ansonia because of the architecture, but also the original architect, whose name was Paul E. DuBois. He himself ended up in an insane asylum.
Wow, that's freaky.
Yeah, which is interesting. And then some of the, like, a great celebrity that lived there was Babe Ruth. So it was kind of talking about, like, he likes picking buildings in New York that have some, like, stories like this and characteristics to them. And he tries to kind of incorporate them in the show to give it a little more character, be it another character. Another one that they talked about was the secret room downstairs is actually part of a church, which the church was called the Church of Intercession. And then actually part of that church is a crypt. So that's the secret room that they're using is also a crypt.
That makes Sofia it even more freaky a little bit. A little more levels on the show.
Yeah, I thought that was kind of cool too, even though, I mean, they shoot a lot of it on a Brooklyn soundstage, but I thought it was very interesting that they took the time to kind of pick these buildings and these places that also have a little, and there was stories about the actual real building having ghosts, and people talked about like a couple ghosts in the
nice sound effect, Steven.
Yeah, so that was my little tidbit this week.
Well, I have a little bit more information on some of the actors. They were at the New York Comic Con, and Vanessa Williams, when asked about her character in the upcoming episode, she mentioned that the Halloween episode that's coming up next weekend is going to show big things for her character. She said that she discussed the dynamic between Olivia and Gavin would change. She said it might not be as simple as it appears. As both characters become more vulnerable and more human, we will learn more about their past in the Halloween episode. So I thought that was interesting. Yes. Then Rachel Taylor, who plays our girl Jane, she said that she thinks that you're going to see more of Jane falling apart, and they're going to see her pull herself together in a different way, but she'll still be Jane. She said she is not someone who is likely to start doing bench presses like Sarah Connor from obviously Terminator, but she said that she is, because she's a very delicate girl, but she said you will see her inner strength in the upcoming episodes.
Get to the chopper.
That's right, get to the chopper. Taylor also promised that even if the plot seems somewhat predictable now, there is no way fans will be able to see where the series is headed. So, you know, there's a lot going on. And I got one more from Mr. Heartthrob. All the girls love Robert Buckley. He said that he was asked about infidelity because his character on the show is obviously peeking through the windows at things that maybe he possibly should not be doing. But Buckley said the idea of being drawn against one's will to infidelity is something he considers terrifying. So portraying this storyline is something of a challenge for him. He said being in a relationship, quote, where there was such a temptation that there was something actually pulling me out of my marriage, because aside from this job, I'm a very big believer in fidelity. That would scare the hell out of me, he said, to be in a spot where I was actually pushed to questioning my relationship and maybe breaking what I've already stood up for my morals. So, sounds like a pretty stand-up guy there, Mr. Buckley. So that's the news and gossip we got this week. Let's go.
We got one more thing.
Oh, we got one more thing?
Didn't they pull, they order a couple more scripts for the show?
They did order two more episodes, which is good. So hopefully, I mean, as we know, we've kind of talked about this in the past, that the ratings haven't been the best for ABC, but we're hoping that maybe the ordering of these two episodes means that we're going to get a longer season. So, good point. So that's our news and gossip for this week. Let's get to some predictions.
And now, your AfterBuzz TV predictions.
I sort of already made my prediction, I think. I think that the guy who comes out of the smoking cloud ghost is actually going to be someone who helps Jane versus not help Jane. So I think that's my prediction. I'm going to go opposite on that. I don't think that he's someone who's going to be evil.
What a twist!
What a twist! Twist. What are you guys, what are your predictions, JJ?
I think he's going to be completely evil and wreak havoc next week. Other than new predictions, I do really think Nona and Jane are going to just team up and really get their psychic abilities in high gear. And I still swear Grandma is going to come back at some point. Not come back, but I think her tie to her grandma is going to be key later on down the road.
And I think I already made my prediction earlier in the episode.
Okay, well, where can everybody be found?
I am at JJ Jurgens on Twitter and at jjjurgens.com.
Sophia.
At Sophia Stanley on Twitter.
You can find me at Derrial Christon, DerrialChriston on Twitter or Facebook. Thank you guys for tuning in for episode 4, Hero Complex 666 Park Avenue. Join us next Sunday night, same time. We're going to be having the Halloween episode 666, so it should be exciting. And we look forward to having you guys tune in.
From Bing.com, executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV Network. To watch or listen to other After shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.